I'm Angie Martosio, and I just moderated an awesome conversation between Barry Gibb and Jason Isbell. They talked about their new duet they just recorded for Barry's new album and writing songs for Saturday Night Fever and A Star Is Born. I just want to start off with just asking of your first memories discovering each other's music.
Oh, yeah. Well, I can certainly start off by saying that this was something I wanted to do because I'm really a fan. I've always been a fan of country music. After the group no longer existed, I drifted into my own bliss, which is this kind of music. And Dave Cobb was really instrumental in helping me do that. And my son Stephen played me some songs, Jason's and Chris Stapleton and people like that, blew me away. So I thought, well, that's the place for me. And the great fun of it is we were making records the way I used to make records when I was about 20 years old, which was you didn't have technology. You didn't have any of those things. So you had a band, the band played, and everyone chooses the best take. And we did it that way. I was going back and recovering the ground where you just sang with the band. And you didn't really think about overdubbing your vocal later. Great experience. Words of a fool, man. Jesus.
Man, that was that. You know, I was nervous, Barry, because I think you got your star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame just a couple months after I was born. So I've known about your music for my whole life, you know.
I was
born in 79, so you're already part of culture when I came into the world, so.
It broke for us about 1967. And so that was the time of like Top of the Pops in England. And there were no things, no Jules Hollands and none of that stuff. But live television, I still miss live music television. I don't know what happened because there was always the midnight specials and there was always the Don Kirshner's rock concert. And you got to just go and play, you know. And that was every Saturday night. And I don't know how to that idea, you know, the idea that you could have six bands in one room.
Yeah, I've done the Jules Holland thing, and we've done Austin City Limits, which is the closest thing that we have to, you know, Don Kirshner's rock concert or something like the Midnight Special or something, you know. But you know, my whole life, I knew about your music. It was part of the vernacular. And honestly, I always heard country influences in your music.
I need to at least give you all that little bit of input as to how our roots came about. We were an immigrant family in Australia in 1958. And from there onwards, for the next 7 years, we heard so many records from America, not necessarily from England, but from America, where mostly music was country music. And it was Roy Orbison, and it was Elvis. And these were country stars, but they were also rock stars. And that's where it crept into our lives. So country music in general, George Jones, Dolly, any of these people had a radical influence on us, you know. And we were out there the other side of the world, and we were listening and living off Australian artists, those being the influences.
The fact that you guys didn't spend those formative years in England,
right?
Do you think that made for a different mix? Because I don't hear as much like Hank Marvin style. I don't hear as much skiffle in what you guys were doing as I hear in a lot of bands from the same era. It sounds more country than skiffle to me. Do you think that's because you were in Australia and you weren't so inundated with that particular type of music?
No, we were inundated with American country music. And don't forget, we went through that whole folk era as well.
So. Oh, totally. Yeah. And those songs like Massachusetts could be a country song. You know, first time I heard it, I thought that could be a country song easily.
Well, I mean, to us they were, but we were kids. We were still figuring out who we should be, what kind of music we loved the most. And what happened to us is that we sort of loved every kind of music. That's why there are so many different styles and so many different insights in the songs that we wrote. Not that we knew that then, but we were simply writing songs, the kind of songs we love. More than anything, I miss the romanticism. I miss beauty in a song.
There's a couple things you did influence-wise that I can't I can't particularly I think there's something that was uniquely you, obviously, you know, in regarding the success you've had writing songs over the years. But there's a couple of things that I hear in your songs, you know, from early on all the way through your career that I don't necessarily hear anywhere else. There's a particular way, especially when you guys came back into the mainstream and when the movie soundtrack happened and when, you know, the music that you were making got more danceable and faster and less folk influenced.
Right.
The R&B influence there was done in a way that to me didn't co-opt any black music. And I think you guys were sort of way ahead of your time because you were making music that affected people in the same way that black R&B records did, but you didn't sound like you were ripping off black artists. You sounded like yourselves.
Yeah.
There's something about that I think a lot of people miss now. They try to make R&B music or what they would call soul music, and they wind up sounding like a caricature of the music that they love. And you guys didn't do that. You sounded unique.
Might have been perceived that way by certain audience people, I mean, whoever listens. But, you know, the truth is the falsetto comes from the Delphonics, comes from the Stylistics, comes from all of those different records where the falsetto was a feature, Brian Wilson, Frankie Valli. It became something that we didn't fear anymore. You know, we discovered it. I discovered it. So I didn't even know I could do that. So when it was time for change, Ahmet Ertegun said, you know, he rejected about 3 songs of the main course album, 75 maybe. And his message was, you guys have got to kick it up. You just got to get away from the pathos. The romanticism, which is another thing I miss. So he said, so the message was, yeah, we'll do another album with you guys. They were going to drop us, you know? Mm-hmm. And Ahmet Ertegun said, but you got to kick it up. We can't use these songs. They're too sad. And so that's where the change came. And Arif Mardin, bless his heart, he was there at the time when we needed a man with his kind of insight, which was the Rascals and other R&B records, a fantastic influence on us. Actually, from a production point of view, taught me a lot about production.
Yeah, sure. I mean, he was a wizard, you know. I mean, people like him and Wexler and Dowd sort of invented everything.
The whole Atlantic scenario, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. But it wasn't a great period for us because we were coming off an album that wasn't successful called Mr. Natural. So that was when Ahmet was going to say, you know, we're done with the Bee Gees, you know. But Robert wouldn't have it, and Robert Stigwood, and he's,
yeah.
No. Well, I don't know what he said, but he said, no. He said, we'll go for one more album and see what happens. We worked once again. Both those albums were Arif Mardin. And from there, I realized one thing, and I've always felt the same way, and that is that music isn't something you listen to, it's something you see. Arif taught me that music is something you see in your mind and in your heart. It's not just something on the radio. Mm-hmm. And when I listen to Gillian Welch in Down from the Mountain, when I hear her talk about bluegrass and how it seemingly seems like simplistic, but it goes very deep, that set me alight as well. And I just love Gillian and Dave, they are just my favorites. And Butterfly was written in 1965, but it never got a chance to be performed. I think we did an okay job on it in Australia, but I wanted to record it again.
It's so beautiful on the album. And I love the way Dave and Gil just sort of, they fold into the melody of the song. You know, David's guitar playing is oh. really special, and it really adds something beautiful. And I like how the documentary ends with that song also. That's the closing credits song on the upcoming documentary.
If there was one song I wanted to record again, it was that one.
I was just happy to be there. You know, the day when you were recording with Allison was one of the coolest things I've ever seen, just to watch the two of you sing together, you know, people from very, very different styles and very different backgrounds. But the way the voices blended, and it was also fun to see Allison nervous. You know, Allison's got 28 Grammys, I think. So it was fun to see her nervous. Something I've noticed about your songs that I never had until the country thing, until this album, until I started to wrap my mind around the way country music has worked for you over the years is the connection between the melodies that you write and the melodies that somebody like Jimmy Webb writes. Right. And honestly, that's the only other person that I could really compare you to melodically, because there's a way that you do tension and release that's, right, I don't understand it. I couldn't do it if I tried. Most songwriters, almost all songwriters, couldn't. Right. Where did the melody set you apart from everybody else in the world?
It's again that really early Australian influence, when there really was no complexity in music. For me, I love Frank Sinatra, I love Nat King Cole, just blows me away. And I'm happy to listen to those people probably more than anyone else, because they really did it. Listening to Nat King Cole sitting there at a piano and singing with perfection, you know?
Yeah.
You couldn't fake anything in those days, you know?
Yeah, and it's complex music too, and they make it seem so simple and so human.
It is simple and sophisticated at the same time. And I think that was the key, probably, because some of our songs seemed simple, but they really weren't. There was a lot of complexity.
They were not. When you try to play them, they are not simple.
Simple as they seem, no. And, you know, we had songs that didn't work as well as songs that did. We had to learn to keep our heads up even when things didn't work out. Boy, this one stiffed. Back to the studio, you know.
How did you do that? How did you, like, I know there was a period of time when you had to, you know, in the 70s, sort of go back to play in some smaller clubs in the north and you know, yeah, before the second wave. How did you keep your head up? How did you stay busy and keep from letting it get the better of you?
Because in a way, we knew that we could sustain by just continuing to work and developing and not worrying about the moment that we were in, you know. So bad news, this record didn't work out. One of us might have said, well, I didn't think it should be a single anyway, or I, you know. And don't forget, it's three brothers, you know, or four brothers, if you like. And we never agreed on everything at all. So it was a great disappointment for some of us when things didn't work out. And it was a great joy when things did. But then we all started having kids. We started raising families, and that became more important than anything else. And what happens is that whatever else you're doing that works or doesn't work, life is okay.
Yeah, you still go home to your family.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, I did a lot of that during the so-called backlash situation after Fever, you know. Yeah, disappointing. There's no question about that, that there was pain, you know. But you've got to pick yourself up and dust yourself off. And we learned how to do that.
And you guys sort of made the blueprint for that. I mean, that was the first time that I know of that a group had gotten huge and then gotten blamed for it for no good reason whatsoever.
Never understood it. Because if something's successful, then why would you? I've always had a problem criticizing anything if it was a number one record, you know?
Yeah.
It's in a row. And then people started putting us down, and we thought, well, you know, I couldn't say that about any artist that had six number one records in a row, you know.
Right, right.
It just blew us away. We just couldn't figure out what to do. But we were having children. Not us personally.
Yeah, right.
And that became the distraction from that type of feeling. We'd always go back into the studio, take another shot. And then we got into programming, which was relatively boring. Then I sort of fell back in love with real people playing real music.
But, you know, things like loops and samples, I don't think a lot of people now realize how big the Bee Gees were for the way a lot of popular production is happening now. Because the Fever soundtrack had the first loop, really, that I know of at all. I mean, the first time a drum loop ran through the whole track.
Two-inch tape, round a Ampex reel, round a brush. And it just kept going round, and a downbeat and a backbeat. And we just kept burying that. More Than a Woman is the same drum loop as Staying Alive. Woman in Love, same drum loop. So we used it on different records. But I think there was some kind of obsession with accuracy. The groove had to be dead on, you know?
So many people do that now. Like, there's entire records and whole careers made with a drum loop that didn't exist before you guys did it.
I don't know if that's true or not. I know that we tried different ways of having really steady, you know, work with Steve Gadd, you don't need a drum loop.
Yeah, that's true.
Levin, who I've worked with here, don't need a drum loop. And a drummer will bring out the emotion in a song. Today, there's just too many downbeats. It's just, you know, you don't hear the drummer really being a drummer, especially on the rap records. Not really a criticism, but real drummers do some amazing things.
Yeah.
They're subtle, but sophisticated as well, you know?
And there's a human aspect of it. Like, you know, I like to be as precise as I can with recordings, but I don't play to a click unless I absolutely have to, just because, I mean, you go back and listen to Rolling Stones records, and some of those songs are almost twice as fast at the end as they are at the beginning.
I don't know if you ever did this, but do you remember cutting a song and then towards the end of the song, you speed it up, the master?
Yeah, I've done that before, yeah.
Because it actually worked. When it went to radio, the idea that the song would build an excitement because you just pushed the speed a hair.
Yeah, just a touch.
Mm-hmm. We did that a lot.
I miss those kind of tricks, you know. I read somewhere that on a couple albums there, the Rolling Stones would bury the lead vocal, so people would have to go out and buy the song books to see what Mick was saying. I miss those kind of recording tricks, you know, the practicality of it.
And I miss the creativity that the Beatles gave to us. I think that they started writing songs coming from a place where you could write about anything. You didn't have to just write about love or write about, you know, you could write about a paperback writer, songs that would, that you would never have written before they did that. And the idea that you can write about any subject whatsoever and make it work.
Yeah, talking about lonely people living everyday lives, that just wasn't a thing that songs did before that, was it?
No, they were playing with our heads. They were being incredibly creative, which is what triggered it all off, you know? And doesn't surprise me that it only lasted 10 years. And the pressure. Yellow Submarine, come on. It's where does that come from and why did it work?
Yeah, why did it work? Yeah, and it works. It still works. Every time I listen to it, my 5-year-old daughter loves it just as much as I do.
Never figure it out, but got to salute them.
I wanted to ask you about your guitar playing style, because I'd been a little familiar with it before we went in the studio together. But when we were working together, it was something that's really different from the way most other people. The closest I could come to is Richie Hayward. Do you remember Richie Hayward?
And he sat in my house and played all night.
Really?
1968, maybe, yeah.
There's something about your guitar playing that reminds me of his, or the other way around.
It is the same type of thing. And also, I believe, could be wrong, that Dolly Parton plays the same way.
I think you're right, yeah.
Yeah, and I think it comes from either bluegrass music, and it also comes from Hawaii. Hawaiian guitar players would tune their guitars the same basic way as country music. And ultimately, it comes from Ireland and Scotland. Migrant music in the first place, you know. For me, it's an open D, starting with the lowest string, D, A, D, F sharp, A, D. And you can bar any chord on the neck with that tuning. You can also find minors and chords you would never have found if you played conventional guitar.
Yeah, you even do like diminished chord, passing chords with that tuning. It's impressive, and it sounds different from any other guitar that's going to be on the recording.
It's a bigger sound.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. It is. Fills in a lot of space. I know that, like, obviously Joni Mitchell had a lot of her own tunings that she made up as she was going, and, you know, Stephen Stills did that. It's always fascinated me the way, you know, different guitar. My friend David Crosby does it all the time. He's still coming up with new tunes.
Oh yeah, no, I love them all. They were in the studio with us when we were doing the vocals to Children of the World, and they just sat along the wall. And that's another thing. In those days, there was no, like, you can't come in here. Everybody visited everybody. And if you're in a building with 6 studios, we had Leonard Skinner next door, we had the Eagles on the other side of the building, all making their own records, but nobody was restricted. You could go to any of those other studios and just sit and listen. You don't see that anymore.
Yeah, we try to do it back home as much as we can. We do step in on each other. And sometimes somebody will come in thinking they're in the A room when they're supposed to be in the B room. You know, once we were recording in Muscle Shoals, where I grew up, and with my old band, and Spooner Oldham, the keyboard player from down there, from the heyday, he showed up, and came in and sat down and hung out with us for about an hour before he realized that he was supposed to be in the other studio that day.
You know, that's what we did, and that's what everyone did, you know? Mm-hmm. And maybe that was just the days of Miami and the Hit Factory, which is Criteria in those days. Maybe that was just the way it was, and nobody was bothered about anyone else visiting.
It's supposed to be fun.
Right. you're also trying to please that person as well. You also want that person to get off, whoever that is.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah, I've had those situations where, like, you know, some of my peers would come into the studio when we were recording, and it's like, oh, let's play on this one, you know, let's see if we can put their jaw on the floor.
So you try to impress each other, and that's just how it was then. That's got to be, what, 77, when that was all happening. And I still work there, still a great studio.
Have you been back to Australia other than touring? Do you go back to stay there?
For the fire show, with fires in Victoria with Olivia Newton-John. And she's always been a very personal experience for me. We grew up together, you know? Mm-hmm. We did the same pop shows in Melbourne, and she came she's an immigrant too. She came back to England same time as us, and we've just known each other all our lives.
Yeah.
You know, her on this album, that's a blessing.
Yeah.
Well, for one thing, and she hadn't sung in a long time, but she was instant. She was instant. Some people are just instant.
Yeah, she's a real one. I mean, a real singer, you know. You're a real singer. I'm a guitar player who had to learn how to sing to make a living in Nashville. I'm not a real singer. I can't tell you what I'm doing. I just sing around the scars and try to hit it. But honestly, on the song that we did together, when I came home, I played it for my wife. She said, that's the best I've ever heard you sing. And I was like, well, yeah, I was singing with Barry Gibb. You know, I had to do my absolute best. It was an incredible experience for me. And I'm sure for everybody else who came in, the whole record is really great, really beautiful. And I love how Dave did it. And I love all the songs and all the singing. And it's a really good piece of work.
Great piece of work. And I'm very proud to have worked with you and to have worked with all those other fantastic artists, you know. Pure pleasure. Once in a lifetime.
Yeah, well, maybe not. Maybe we'll do it again.
I actually had a question. The song that you guys duet on, Barry, is that an unreleased song?
Yes. Well, it's sort of unreleased. We were still going through all that backlash stuff. So anything I did or anything my brothers did was really not getting on the air. So, but that was one of the songs. I just didn't like the recording. I love the song. And I used to do it every time we did a sound check. I would do that song. Everybody loved it, but it was never a record. It never really went out. Words of a Fool, one of the best pieces of songwriting I've ever heard. For me.
It's a great song. It's a great song. It really is. But it's a country song. It sounds like a country song, straight up.
A little bit of gospel in it. It's got a little bit of pain. Wisdom is fine, but the heart leads the way. If I hadn't written it, it's the kind of song I would have liked to, you know? Mm-hmm. But even when it came about, I don't even remember. But it's one of my favorite tracks on the album. I think Capitol wanted that to definitely be in the first three. And that was Steve Barnett's choice, followed by Run to Me with Brandy.
Yeah, that one's really nice. Brandy can sing, man. She's a real singer. That's a real singer there.
Great. But you guys all are. That's what attracted me to the whole thing, is that you guys didn't need to do this. There was nothing in life where you really had to do that. But the fact that you cared about those songs means everything to me.
Thank you. And it was the songs, you know, we heard the songs and I heard you sing and your voice is still so powerful and you have control over it. And everything you're doing to me is just as viable and as necessary as it's ever been. So I was happy to get in there and help out.
I actually have a couple questions I wanted to ask. You guys both, I discovered this the other day, I thought about it. In terms of movies, obviously, Barry, you have Saturday Night Fever, you have Grease, and Jason, you contributed a song to A Star Is Born. Can you guys tell me about that experience and what that was like for you?
You go first.
I'll go first. Mine's going to be a shorter story. So, you know, I wrote the song. Dave Cobb, again, put me in a situation that I was really lucky to be in. He was working with Mark Ronson and with Gaga and Lucas Nelson. And, you know, they were working on the music for that movie. And Dave came to me and said, I need you to write a song for this character. He needs a hit, you know. And I said, well, Dave, I've never written a hit before in my life. You come to the wrong guy, you know. But then he explained the character, and it wasn't exactly the same as the Streisand Christofferson version. You know, it was a little different. This guy was more of a folk singer. I said, well, I'd be happy to participate in a universe where one of my songs might be a hit, even if it's not real life. It'd be good to watch it on screen, you know. So I wrote that. I took a song that I'd been working on for a while, and I changed it up a little bit. And then Bradley Cooper sang it in the movie. And I was worried because nobody'd ever heard Bradley sing before. And I thought, well, we'll see how this goes. And so he sent me his recording of it, and I was just about to get on a flight. And I thought, I don't want to listen to this right now, because if it's bad, you know, he sent me the recording. He's like, what do you think? Is this okay? I was like, if this is bad, I don't want to have to call Bradley Cooper back, who's directing the movie and starring in it, and say, yeah, sorry, this is not going to work for me. Right. So I just got on the flight. I thought, he probably doesn't care anyway. It's not a big deal. He's going to use this song. It's done. So I got on the flight, and I responded to him about 4 hours later after I'd flown across the country. And it was good. I listened to it. He did a lot of, like, work. He took vocal lessons. He did a good job singing. Mm-hmm. So I wrote back, and I said, this is great. You know, thanks for working so hard on it. And I didn't find out until the movie came out that was the moment that made him the most nervous. Somebody asked him in a panel, like, what was the hardest part about making this movie? And he said, well, I sent Jason the copy of the song when I recorded it, and he didn't respond to me for like 4 hours. And I was sweating bullets the whole time. And I thought he wouldn't care, you know. So it was a great experience for me, because they didn't change the song. They kept it exactly like I'd written it. I expected them to come back with changes, but they never did. So it was great.
You always expect that, but it's a great film and a great song. And Jesus, you should be proud.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. Our story is, we recorded those songs in Herivel outside Paris. And I think it was some kind of tax thing. It didn't relate to our taxes, but the company was picking places for us to play where the taxes wouldn't affect the company. So we were in Paris, outside Paris, in the Chateau, with the Elton John album, Honky Chateau, same place. Mm. And it used to be an old, it was actually an old brothel, believe it or not. And it was a totally run down building. The studio was amazing, but it was totally run down too. So we were in the worst possible circumstances, and especially for making records. So, and then our drummer got his, I think one of his parents got very sick. So we didn't have a drummer. And so that's where the desire for something that sounded like drums came from, you know? And so Night Fever, More Than a Woman, Staying Alive, If I Can't Have You, were written on the stairs of that building, in the dark, you know. And If I Can't Have You was really more about ABBA than us. We just wanted to write an ABBA song. In fact, that's one of our traits. We always wanted to make a record like so-and-so. Let's do a Beach Boys type of song. Let's do a Beatles type of song. And we were not ashamed of that. We just loved, if we loved a kind of music, then we try to come up with something like that. And I've done that same thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Let's write a song like those, like that one, you know. So you do, you're influenced by everything, and you didn't copy, but you were influenced, you know. Mm-hmm. And so that's how those songs came about. We never saw the script. In fact, the original title was Tribal Rites of a New Saturday Night, and Stigwood called us up and said, we're going to send you the script, we want you to record these songs. We just finished mixing a live album and went straight into those songs and finished them in Miami. How Deep Is Your Love, my favorite. Mm. So that's how that came about. Nobody knew it was going to do what it did. Nobody, you know, and especially Robert. So I think it was a shock for all of us at the moment that it started doing a million a week. You don't know how many records you sell. But in those days, a million a week, everyone took notice, you know?
Yeah, I mean, that was the biggest selling record of all time up until Thriller, right?
one of the biggest soundtracks, but I don't know if it's the biggest, to be honest.
Okay.
I don't know. I think David Foster thinks The Bodyguard is.
Well, but that was after Thriller. I mean, between the time y'all released it and Thriller, it was the biggest, right?
As a soundtrack,
yeah.
We could always claim that, or someone representing us would always claim that. But ultimately, we never knew how many records we sold, anything about those things. We didn't know how to copyright a song. So it was really just get on with the music. God, I wish it was like that now.
I wish so too, because I have to know all that shit. I have to know all of it all the time.
We're living in a period where we can't find a stage to play on.
Yeah, that's a whole new ball game. What have you been doing since you've been in the pandemic life?
Watching Netflix and always watching Down from the Mountain. I love the PBS stuff. The moments of the 50s and different periods of time. There's that one guy that does different eras.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I love that stuff. The Duprees blow me away.
Hopefully, yeah. I mean, I do a lot of that too. Hopefully, we're educating ourselves some more while we're in here. I sit and play the guitar all day, you know, some days, and that still does me a lot of good.
If I play, I'm playing for myself, you know. Mm-hmm. But if I like the song, I'll applaud.
Yeah, right. That's all it takes. One pair of hands clapping, and you're good.
But, you know, that's where we are now. So I wait for the day when someone's going to let me go on stage again. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, me too.
That's where your joy is, you know?
Yeah, and it's not for me. I mean, there is part of that connection with the audience, but a huge part of it is just connecting with the other musicians on stage and having that kind of horsepower behind you, feeling like you're piloting a ship, you know?
Eyeballing each other, knowing that something wonderful just happened.
Yeah.
How it happened. Yeah. That was great.
Yeah, I missed that a lot.
Yeah, me too. But it'll come back. We'll get that chance again. You know, I feel for every single artist that can't go on stage right now. People that really embrace going on stage. And that's a shame. That's a great shame. Yeah.
You know, I feel like I just sort of barely made it to the point where I'm successful enough to where when things reopen, you know, I'll be part of the first group of people to go back out and play because I can draw a lot of tickets in a lot of cities. But there's a lot of people who didn't get to that point, and they're going to go out in the venues that they would have been playing might not be open anymore. The people who are in the middle of building a career, you know, those places aren't going to be around. And a lot of those folks will go back into the workplace, and we'll never hear of them. We'll never know they were going to be musicians.
It's really sad. But the best talent out there is not getting those opportunities, you know?
Yeah.
But you got to feel for everyone else too. See, what is it? 60% of all businesses that closed will not reopen.
That's what I've heard. Yeah. Always worse. You know, as soon as I start feeling sorry for myself, I look out the window and it's like, I'm all right. Things are fine with me. You know.
Yeah, I've been through that. I gave it up. Mm-hmm. There's no point in being sorry for yourself when you see what the state other people are in. Got to keep laughing and hope you get a chance to play again. And even if you're on your own and it's like this.
If I have to, I'll drag a Marshall out in the front yard and play for the neighborhood. I'm getting there. I'm close to that point right now.
Yeah, me too. Me too. But every room I go into, there's a guitar. So
yeah,
if it's there, if I get the feeling, then I'm going to do it.
It's been reminding me more of the reason I started making music in the first place when I was a kid. Just the real like essence of why I sit down and play.
Right. Do you know the first gig we ever played publicly was a Speedway. The stock cars and the little racing cars and things like that. We talked the people there into letting us sing in the middle of the oval between the races, you know? And we're on the back of a lorry, back of a truck with a microphone. And then the people threw coins onto the track. That's how it began.
See, that could have happened in Alabama. That sounds like something that very easily could have happened where I grew up.
I would say that there's definitely a lot of likenesses, especially when you talk about the tent shows. And there's a thing called the Easter Show in Sydney where they're all like sideshows. We did sideshows, you know, and 5 songs a show. And then you go stand out front and the guy points at you with a stick. You know, just, you know, step right out, come right in. I don't think there was ever a situation where we didn't play. We played the Crocodile Dundee pubs, some places you wouldn't go into. Rough 1958 early Australian, just growing up with that feeling that there was always going to be a fight breaking out in the middle of your show, or a brawl where the whole place erupts, you know, chairs fly across the room.
I did a couple places that had chicken wire up in front of the stage, you know, when I was a teenager. But back then, you know, the beer bottles would have just bounced off me anyway, because I was 16 years old. Now it would put me down for 6 months. But back then, I didn't care. I didn't care about a fight, you know.
No, I didn't care about that. I've seen the worst of it. I've seen the worst of it, where a whole club would erupt. But incredible growth. Some of those people, like there was a guy called Billy Thorpe. I don't know if you ever heard of him. And the guy called Johnny O'Keefe. Johnny O'Keefe was the biggest star, but he could sing his ass off. And Cole Joy was another one. Cole Joy is the guy that got us signed to Festival Records in Sydney. These were major recording stars, but they weren't known outside Australia.
That combination was a unique one, I think, for you guys. I think, you know, that's one of the many reasons why you didn't sound like anybody else.
Well, I mean, it's not something we would have ever known. We sort of thought we had an Everly Brothers type of sound. Because we love the Everly Brothers.
So, but you had another harmony part that Phil and Don didn't have.
But we were kids and the voices were high anyway. So Morris could go from really the highest harmony to the lowest harmony if he wanted to. Robin's voice is unmistakable and unique, you know.
Yeah.
So we would share leads, or we would split, or we, depending on the song, we'd make up our minds who was going to sing the song before we actually decided to record it, you know. So we didn't have those conflicts. Once you have any kind of success, then it becomes a competition. If you're a family, you can make it last. If you're not a family, then I think things can fragment pretty quickly.
But yeah, I've definitely seen that. You know, I was in a band for a long time where we had three songwriters and three different singers, you know, and it was a tough thing. I mean, ever since then, I've kind of felt like I do my best when I'm either being told what to do. You know, if somebody's giving me instructions, I'll do whatever you say, or if I'm making the decisions. But anything in between, I haven't been all that good at.
Well, once Dave was producing this particular album, I had to give up that sense of being a producer. And I had to listen and follow the way he wanted to do things, you know. That was a great experience, because I had to relinquish that authority thing, you know.
Yeah, I did that with Dave too. When I got sober, I wrote and then recorded my first album with Dave. Like, I'd made albums before, but I'd always either produced or co-produced all of those.
Right.
And so when I went through the process, it's been about 8.5 years ago of going to rehab and sobering up, I thought, well, maybe one of the things that I need to turn over this sort of myth of control to is my work, you know. Come in with the songs written and then let Dave tell me how to make them sound. And it turned out to be a really great thing for me, but it was hard to let go of that because they're so precious. You know, you don't want somebody to screw them up.
And that was the first time for me to not be in charge of the record. And that was a great pleasure. Hard, but at the same time, a lot of good actors that are also good directors. And what you will see is that they will not direct every move they make, you know?
Right.
You let someone else do that. You've got to be ultimately the guy that makes the decision, but you got to listen to everybody. And you just deal, you know, throw out what doesn't work for you and keep what someone said, you know?
Yeah.
And that's how it's always been.
I think that's the thing probably that impresses me about you the most, even though I've written a lot of songs and I've admired the way you write songs for a long time. The fact that you are, you know, so committed to being a good human being. You have a family that you're close to that you've had around for a long, long time, and you've not allowed your abilities to give you an excuse to act like a bad person. And I appreciate that.
You learn as you go, and my feet really never left the ground. So once you've had a couple of failures, you begin to realize that failure is always just around the corner. And success is a bit like a sponge. You're walking on a sponge. Remember.
Yeah.
You will start to sink. And just the very principle that nothing lasts, no matter what you do. Nothing. It doesn't matter who you are. nothing lasts. So you prepare yourself for the time when it's fine to just watch TV or read. But I'm at that point in life where I'd love to be able to do it. I'd love to be able to walk on another stage.
Hopefully one of these days we can go out and do that song together somewhere live. I would love that.
I would love it, man. You know, we were making this album. We never thought for a second that anything like this was going to happen.
It was a good time, and I'm glad that we did it. But maybe we can go out and show it to people one day.
I'd love it.
I think that's amazing, guys. Thank you so much.
Fantastic. Thank you. I appreciate you guys for putting this all together.
Oh, this was so much fun. I was really excited about it.
Good, good. Well, it's great for me. Thank you so much, Barry.
Thank you, man. Thank you.
And thanks, Stephen, too. Tell Stephen I said, hey, I hope he's well. There you are.
Started it all.
You look good, man. You look good back there.
Thanks, buddy. It's good to see you, bro. Talk
soon. Good to see you.
All right, Jason. You take care of
yourself.
All right. Thank you,
guys. Thank you so much. Have a great week.